This video is sponsored by Control Plane. Previously on City Fast Fresh Deploys with Rust.
So again, nobody's saying that any of this is a good idea. I can feel this is going to be annoying. Now, you're probably wondering, and you would be correct, one down, two to go. I forgot that we had binary payloads. Now we have postcount everywhere. In the Surrey data model, there's maps and there's sequences. That means that it uploaded everything. Yeah, we can see our files. Look at that. It uploaded everything. So, how do we have a production database? Control Plane lets you access resources from Amazon or Google or Azure from your workloads. And it does that by having agents. And you can see I already have an agent because I've already deployed one thing to Control Plane and it's my self-hosted analytics. So I already have an agent. It's just an EC2 instance somewhere on Amazon. So I'm gonna have you take a look at my console. So everything we're doing is going to be in Frankfurt, EU Central 1, and you can see I have one instance running and it's called Control Plane Agent Umami. And its only purpose is to proxy data from any workloads on Control Plane to any private Amazon resources. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a new database on Amazon. So I already have a couple instances here. I'm going to make a new one. Aurora is the Amazon brand database thingy, Postgres compatible. I think we use 14.7 for our testing, so we're just going to do that. Well, we're going to pretend it's a production database. Instance class is going to be serverless. Minimum ACU of 1, maximum of 2. I don't want to replicate. This is the silliest use case for a Postgres database, which is storing our source code. Like, we're basically using Postgres like Git. Do not connect to EC2. IPv4 is fine. It's the same virtual private cloud. No public access. There we go. We can create that. So this part might take a hot minute. This is why I wanted to do that first. And now what we're going to do is we're going to edit our workload to have sort of fresh. And I think that's all we need. This is going to restart the container. We need to just push. Actually, okay, first of all, you can see how it was transferring 2 GB of context. We need the dockerignore file. Or ignore target. Deploying was a little faster there because some layers already existed. It's only pushing what's missing. And now if we do, let's look at our just file. We have a just run thing. Build should be a no op. And then, yeah, we should set serve mode. So docker run lets us set environment variables, serve mode, serve fresh. That's not going to be enough because it's going to want database URL. And database URL might not work because this is inside Docker and the database is outside Docker, but let's see what happens. Address not available because localhost, yes. I think it's like host networking. Host mode networking, container network second, not isolated from Docker host, does not get its own IP address space. Okay, it's doing stuff. So this is still working. It's still taking a bit of time to load up. Cool. Is our database ready? That is the big question. Yes, it is successfully created, kind of. Okay, it's available. So now we have an endpoint here, which we are going to expose using our agents. So we're going to make a new identity called refresh. No cloud access, but then network resources. We're going to be using the existing agent I already have, and this is going to be refresh DB. Discover using the fully qualified domain name, which Amazon gave us here. This resolves publicly, I believe. Yeah, it's a private IP address, but it's a public DNS record. Resolver IP doesn't matter, and one port is required, is 5432, which is the Postgres port. Now we can create that, and the connection string is going to be, I believe that's right. So this is the protocol, this is the user, this is the password, this is the host, which is going to be an entry, just like when you have Docker Compose and you have a database as one of the services, because we're going to be using that identity, we're going to have a fresh DB. entry in etc host, so it's going to resolve to the actual IP address of the agent, which is going to expose that for us. And slash Postgres is the database name. So that should work, but then we also want to choose an identity here. So at this point in the video, you might be wondering why I just flashed my Postgres master password in the video without censoring it. And the reason is because it's not accessible publicly. You have the domain name, you have the username, the password, but you can't access it because you would need to be either in my global virtual cloud or in my VPC on Amazon, and you're not. The way you should attack this website is to hit the deploy endpoint, which I haven't secured in any way, and you could just deploy whatever there. And while it's cooking, we're going to make a new workload called refresh deploy ingest. So we know it listens on port 9000. The image is going to be what we already have, which is refresh latest. And serve mode is going to be deploy ingest. Yes, identity is going to be refresh. Firewall will allow all. So this is where I could allow list only my IP address. But for now, I'm just going to allow all inbound requests, no tags, and create. And again, we can look at deployments to see what's running. Okay, this one seems ready. That one's still pending because I'm assuming that it's now compiling the app. Yep, downloading dependencies. Let's see here. And here they are. Only took 6.43 seconds. And if we reload, it's really fast. So it's really only the first request that like takes a while to build all the TypeScript. And so refresh deploy ingest is also working, apparently. It's green. It says all migrations applied. And if we try to open that, it'll give us a 404. But that now means that we should be able to deploy directly to there. And this is where I realized that in here, I'm formatting with plain text HTTP, which might be fine. I don't actually think we redirected HTTP to HTTPS or anything. So let's run deploy, but the host name is going to be this. And the port is going to be 80, or just no port. Oh, this here is unexpected end. Let's look at the logs. 405, method not allowed. Oh, it's doing a 301 to there. Okay, so it is redirecting to HTTPS. The problem here is that control plane is returning a 301 moved permanently. And when you get a 301, you have to use get or head to do the target of the redirect. If you want the post to stay a post, you need to use a more recent status code that is 308 permanent redirect. We'll just have the deploy ingest address have the protocol. This is something we could have figured out with the tracing. If we install tracing subscriber, we would have seen where the requests ended up being. Okay, so, ooh, hey. It worked already. If we do another deploy, it should upload zero files. Yeah. Wow, that's pretty fast. And this is not even with like a release build. Let's make a release build. It ran in 600 milliseconds. I mean, it's a no-op, but something I also forgot to check is that if we change this, it should upload the change file. So this should go, upload one file. And then it's still 600 milliseconds. Okay, cool. Yeah. All right, I'm happy with that. So the thing we're missing now is for the serve fresh part of it to listen for notifications through Postgres. So in make revision, we should notify that the revision is there. Notify revision. And now in the serve fresh thingy, we should have PG listener. This is going to be done in a task, I suppose. So spawn, make a new listener, and then loop. So we could be sending the revision ID here, but we're just going to query the latest from here because this is something we're going to need to do at startup anyway. this is the ingest. We're gonna do a three-way split. This is serve fresh. And then when we deploy, yeah, we get a revision notification you can see down here. And now it gets kind of tricky with the code because we want kind of blue-green deployment, essentially. And blue is going to be 3001, green is going to be 3002. And then the paths are going to be like whatever, temp path. There we go. The optimized way of doing this would be to kind of cache locally all the files that we've already downloaded. And then, you know, if we already have them on disk, just read them from disk. And I'm not going to do that, but the design would allow that, which is an important part. When we get a new revision, we're actually just going to download everything from the revision and then put it in one of those folders and then run deno in there. That's the important part. So the initial revision is going to be current BG. Yeah, it's going to be blue. What's this called? Deploy? Yeah, it's deploy. This is something that should run all the time. But it should connect based on what the current deploy is. So this should be like an arc mutex deploy or like read write lock. Let's do that. And should it be async? I don't believe so. Oh, look, it's another thing I didn't really explain in the video. So you have both synchronous locks and asynchronous locks. Basically, asynchronous locks, you want them when you want to hold onto the lock, so the lock guard, across a wait point, which we don't need to do here. The only thing that's there is, are we currently on a blue deploy or on a green deploy? So we're going to acquire the lock and then make up a port number, 3001 if it's blue, 3002 if it's green. And that's all that's gonna happen with it. And we can immediately release the lock guard. If we needed to maintain that lock throughout across await points, then we'd want an async lock. But here we can have a synchronous lock, which is actually faster. So when we have a connection here, we should read the port. This is fallible, right? Because these can be poisoned, yes. And deploy is moved because we do this. Okay, yeah. So this is something we want to spawn at the beginning here. Oh, and deploy is clonable. Yes, but no, because we want to wrap that in like an arc read write lock. But then the annoying part is we want to fetch the new revision, unpack it in the folder and launch deno and like changing where the proxy proxies to. And you know what I say about annoying things? We can always keep them for later. That's not what I say. I'm not that type of person. Anyway, in the next part, everything comes together and Rust is trying to save us from ourselves, but we cannot be helped. We're going for it anyway. It's glorious.